As police abuse survivors ourselves, former and current residents, we launched the Revolutionary Legal Advocacy Project in 2007. That's RLAP.
That's jailhouse lawyers outside of jail without a degree, making sure that poor folks living and surviving in America KKK can actually have some kind of advocacy, even if they don't have money for a lawyer.
That's the thing, nobody knows. Right? FBI comes in.
Right.
And it's like an alien sighting. It's like, oh, did anybody see it? You know? Because I heard it. And I guess they've been in contact with the district attorney, but I haven't heard anything. And I'm the one that released the videotapes.
Absolutely.
But, you know, I mean, I felt that that there always needed to be an independent investigation.
Right.
That it didn't make sense for the police or the DA to investigate this case, because our district attorney was the police chief formerly when these officers were, engaged in this misconduct. And I think that it makes sense for the federal government to come in. I just hope that they're transparent and they're accountable, so we know what's happening. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't a legal conflict of interest. The police officers, had they been charged by him, would have been able to raise a conflict of interest. So he could still investigate it. I spoke to him, and he said that he felt that he could investigate it. And so I took him at his word. And then he told me that he thought the investigation was, you know, that they didn't have the resources to be able to do it.
Interesting.
So I don't know what happened, you know. I'd be interested to find out what information the FBI gave him that caused him to do make the decision that he did. Right. Well, here at the Public Defender's Office, I mean, we provide legal representation for about 25,000 people a year.
Oh, interesting.
And part of our job is to ensure that folks' constitutional rights are not violated. And we do have a constitution in this country, last time I checked, at least a part of it. What happened was is that one of the attorneys in the office had a case, and for years and years we've had reports of police officers who went into a person's room, particularly in the single residence hotels in the city, without a warrant, and in some cases using a master key. Now, you're supposed to have a warrant before you go into somebody's house.
Absolutely.
That's what the law says. That's what the Fourth Amendment says. And so we've had these reports in the past, and we've argued in court that these were illegal entries.
Mm-hmm.
What happened in this case is that there was a video. And what happened is that at the Henry Hotel, which is right here on 6th Street in San Francisco, there was a arrest of a person on a drug charge. And it turned out that our client said, hey, there's no warrant that they presented, and they just went right into the room. And when the attorney looked at the police report said something very different. Now, this is not unusual.
Right.
But what the client said is, you know what, there's a video in that hotel. And so he went, the attorney sent the investigator from the office to the Henry Hotel, and they were able to secure a copy of the video. And guess what? The video showed that what the client said was the truth, that he was telling the truth about what had happened. And if you had read the police report said that they knocked on the door, that they got the person's consent, and they even had a consent form that was signed. And you look at the video, and they're just going in the room. What happened on the video is that you see them going into the room, you see them pulling people out, and then some minutes later, you then see them supposedly get a consent form signed after they're already in the room. I mean, you know, that's not how it's supposed to work. So that led to other videos being discovered, because it turned out that they had videos at this hotel. And so they we began requesting videos and began finding not only were there several instances, but there appeared to be a pattern of activity by this group of police officers who were consistently either going to people's rooms without warrants and then lying about it in the police report. And, you know, you can look at the video and read the police report. And when you are a police officer and you write a police report, it's under penalty of perjury.
Yes.
So it's a sworn statement.
Yes. I know.
So you can't have a criminal justice system predicated on perjury and, and lies, and and that's what was happening in these cases. I mean, remember that when a person, you know, is arrested and there's a police report,
yes,
filled out, that is what the prosecutor relies upon in deciding whether to bring charges.
Sworn statement.
See, what happened is a week after these videos came out, we found out there was another video of a man. What had happened is that the police went into, again, somebody's room, and they found some drugs, and there were drugs in a jacket. And so there were a number of people in the room, and they said, oh, you know, this jacket belongs to this person, because we saw you wearing this jacket when you went into the hotel. It was a white jacket, and they found it on a chair. And the guy said, hey, it's not my jacket. This is my jacket. It was a different jacket, a black jacket. Well, we went and looked at the videotape, and guess what? It showed him going into the hotel with a black jacket. And
so,
in the police report, this is an important part, the police report clearly said that the police officer claimed that he saw him walking into the hotel with that jacket. You know what I think happened? They didn't see him going in the hotel at all.
No.
They basically were in that room, and they said, hey, we're putting that jacket on you. Now, he was in jail for 3 weeks. He was looking at some major time in state prison.
Right.
Hey, if it wasn't for that videotape, he'd probably still be there.
And the women don't never get respected, and the problems don't never get solved, and the jobs don't never pay enough, so the rent always be late.
I mean, you shouldn't have to do that. You know, people should be following the Constitution, especially police officers. But yeah, I mean, the response that we got to a letter that I sent asking the police department and the district attorney's office to join me, and to be fair, it was just the police department that responded this way. They said, oh, you know, it's just like sticking your boot, you know, in somebody's door kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, and my response to that is, one, they're not taking it seriously, and two, I mean, what we're asking them to do is agree on what the Constitution says, that that the practice, here's what should be outlawed. The practice of, you know, me as the hotel owner or the clerk in the front, you come in as a police officer, hey, I need to get in room 12. And I'm like, well, okay, here's the key. And you take the key and go up there and open the door. Now, if you got a search warrant to go in the house, yeah, sure, you can use a key, just like you can use anything else to get into that house if you have a search warrant.
Right.
The problem is if you don't have a search warrant, right? That sort of pattern and practice is leading, you know, is leading to flagrant violations of constitutional rights, the civil rights. We know that.
Right.
So why don't we stop it? And so the answer is yeah.